your CV. I have not received, but can you just send me a screenshot on the WhatsApp if it is possible, sir? Sure. Meantime, I have logged in, sir. Did you log in? Oh, one moment. I'll do one thing. So I'll send you a link on the mail right now. Okay, just click on that mail so that you can just log in as a panelist. Before we start the activity, we can still do some testing. I'll just send you a mail right away, sir. Yeah, thank you. Sir, I sent you a mail. Just see if you got the mail, sir.
Scopy. As Fanindra told, I'm working as assistant professor in biological and life sciences, School of Art and Sciences, Ahmedabad University. Before I start microscopy, I would like to introduce my school, the School of Art and Sciences, which is basically working in a different way as compared to the other institutions. Here, the study is related to the liberal arts as well as the science, where the science student can take this music subject, and as well as science student can take the subject of psychology, history, and many other subjects also. Means there's no foundation of the streams in the School of Art and Sciences, Ahmedabad University. This is a building of new building of School of Art and Sciences, Ahmedabad University. And this is a small building of biological research laboratory where currently we are working with a different type of domain of research, including the forensic research also. Our motto is basically the nurturing the science knowledge and innovation in all the domains, all the area of research. There's no any boundaries of the research is exist in this particular laboratories. So now after the introduction of my institutions, now I'm start with the microscopy, how the microscopy is actually evolution is going on. So microscopy as a term is ancient Greek word that is a micros means is small and scopian means to see, means it object or an instrument through which we can see the small thing which we cannot see by the naked eyes. So here, first of all, to the student, I would like to say ki once the innovation is started, innovation is basically is a regular process or the progressive things. So how you can see here how the microscopy is basically developed, which we have seen nowadays. It is started in 1000 AD with the reading stones that's invented in that particular era. And after that, the Roman experimented with the different type of shape and thickness of the glasses, which basically provide the larger image of the object. And those type of glasses they called as a reading stones. But this is happened till the 13th century until it is not used as a worn as a glasses. So in the 1284, the Italian person has developed the wearable glasses. Wearable glasses is basically the supporting system is only on the nose. You can see here that is the nose is only the supporting system. There is no any system to support the ears. And why they developed this particular thing? The reason behind that, for seeing the reading material, eyes is required, not the hand is needed at that moment. And why unnecessary we busy our hand? To overcome this issue, they developed this particular wearable glasses. And after that, in 1590, in between, there's a lots of thing happened. They prepare a small type of glasses, a small type of things. And then slowly, slowly, they find the some specific type of glasses, which is in between, there's a thick, and on the edges, they are thin. They are actually work as a reading material. Means you can see the large image of reading material through these type of glasses. And these type of glasses, they gave the name as a lentils. It is a Latin word, lentils, which is basically why they are giving this name, because it looks like a lentil beans. And it is then convert into the lens. And in this way, the lens term is derived from the lentils. And in 1590, two spectacles makers, one is Zacharias Johnson and second is Hans Johnson. Zacharias is a son and Hans is a father. And they using the two different type of lensing to see the object. And they find that as compared to seeing the object with the one only glass material, if they're using the two different type of glasses, then the enlargement and their resolution is much higher as compared to the earlier one. So this particular invention of Johnson and Johnson actually known as a first prototype of the microscope. After that, in 1670, the Robert Hooke first time see the dead cells with the help of this particular microscopes, which he had prepared. And after that, in 1674, the big revolution came in the field of microscopy, when the Leeuwenhoek, who is basically interested to learn how to make the lenses by grinding and polishing, and he makes a small type of lenses with the great curvatures. And then he find that not only the dead cells, even we can see the bacterias, the viruses, which cannot be seen by the naked eyes. And this is a big revolution in the field of microscopy as well as in the field of biology. And that is the reason the Antoine von Leeuwenhoek is called as father of microscopy. After this revolution in the field of microscopy till the 19th century, it is going on. There's some little bit improvement is every time is happened. But in 1903, the another big thing happened with the ultra microscope development. Ultra microscope, why they require this ultra microscope, why they want to develop these type of microscope. The reason behind that, before that, they can see the things by the naked eyes, only those range of the things they can see with the help of microscope till now. But they want to see the beyond the range of the normal visible wavelength. And then they develop, Zsigmondy is basically developed the ultra microscope concept. And after that, in 1932, the phase contrast microscope is developed by the Zernik. Why he basically comes with a phase contrast microscope? Before this, only the bacteria can see, but the little bit bulk eukaryotes cannot see that. Means you can see the prokaryotes with the help of the microscope, which is developed by the Leeuwenhoek. But eukaryote is still can't see with the help of this type of microscope. So then the Zernik has developed the microscope, which is called as a phase contrast microscope. And with the help of this particular microscope, the individual cells can also be seen.
I have a small intervention. So your screen is not shared yet.
Oh, sorry. Is it?
Not yet, sir. One minute.
I think something from your side, Fanind.
No, just have a check, sir.
Yeah, sure. Is
yes.
it?
Yes, sir. It's.
Thank you. Sorry for inconvenience.
No.
This is Anthony von Leeuwenhoek, who's basically developed the microscope. With the help of that, the bacteria can see. And then ultramicroscope developed by Zsigmondy. With the help of that, the beyond the visible range, we can see the objects. And then Zernik has developed the phase contrast microscope in 1932. And with the help of this one, the individual cell, living cells, can be seen by the help of this particular microscope. After that, in 1937, they developed another dimension of the microscope. Before that, all the microscope is basically based on the light, means the source of that particular microscope is a light. And then they developed another one, that is an electron microscope, where instead of light, they are using the electron beam to focus on the object and increase the resolution, because the wavelength of the electron beams is much, much lower as compared to the light sources. So in, that is developed in 1937, but due to the Second World War, it started at the point of 1939 to 45. So this is not introduced into the market. But after the finishing of the this Second World War, the scanning electron microscope developed first, and then electron transmission electron microscope come into the picture of the science. And in 1981, the another microscope, which is basically to see the object in the atomic level, the scanning tunneling microscope developed. So you can see from here, the glass is stone, the story is started of the microscope, and they're moving, and then finally they reach to the see the object with the atomic level also. And after that, recently in 2014, the Eric Bedzik, Stephen Hall, and William Morner received the Nobel Prize in Chemistry 2014 for the development of the super resolved fluorescent microscopy. And what is the application of this particular microscope? So with the help of this particular microscope, they can view the 3D image of the biological structure at the nanoscale. And that is the reason why they got the Nobel Prize. And in 2017, another Nobel Prize received in the field of microscopy by the Jacques, Frank, and Henderson for development of the cryo-electron microscopy. Because before that, the electron microscope transmission or scanning electron microscope can only work for those type of compounds or those type of material which can vacuum, means the cryo compound, cryo samples or liquid sample cannot be run in the normal transmission and the scanning electron microscope. While with the help of this cryo electron microscope, if the molecule present in the liquid also, they can easily monitor those type of the structure of the biomolecules. So for this 2017, they got the Nobel Prize. So you can see that it is started, microscopy started very long back, but it's still in 2017, they got the Nobel Prize. And that is the reason why I chose this particular topic. People think that microscopy is a very normal thing and we used many times, but how the development is going on in the field of microscopy, and from the optical microscope, now we enter into the nano dimension microscope as well as the cryo electron microscope. So it is giving a chance to the new budding scientists to work in the particular field of microscopy and develop the new paradigm of the microscopy in near future also. So now I'm going to start with the topic. In this topic, I'm going to cover a few things. First is, which is related to actually the forensic microscopy. So first is the bright field microscope. And this bright field microscope is basically contain the four different type of bright field microscope. One is a compound, second is a stereoscopic, third one is a comparison microscope, and then the polarizing microscope, and their forensic application. Then the next one is a dark field microscope, which is comes after the bright field microscope. And all the microscope is developed because there's some limitations present in the previous one. And then the second one is comes. So then the dark field microscope come into the picture. Then phase contrast microscope and their forensic application. Then fluorescent microscope. Then electron microscope, which is the latest one, transmission and scanning electron microscope. So before we start with the microscope, there's a few terminology which you are all are aware with this. The first is a lens, which is the most important part of the microscope. It is a glass piece, which is transparent, made up of transparent material. And it is basically used to just to converge or diverge the light rays or the source of light. And second is a magnification, which is amount of subject is enlarged by lens system and the objective eyepiece is which is basically used for the magnification. Next is a working distance. Working distance is a distance between the object which is present on the stage and the lenses. This particular distance is called as a working distance. And depth of field. Depth of field is basically the sharpness of the object. What range of the object distance can give a sharp image? That is the depth of field of that particular microscope. Next is the depth of focus. Many people is confused with the depth of field and depth of focus. Depth of focus is basically the surrounding of the particular object. When they are giving the sharpness, that is basically the depth of the focus. Resolution is basically ability to find the difference between the two entities. Here you can see there's a, you cannot distinguish these two molecules, while here it is little bit better as compared to this one. And finally, here you can easily resolve the two entities which is present here. Next is the angle of acceptance. Angle of acceptance is the how much light is accepted by the objective lens. That angle is basically called as angle of acceptance. Refractive index, which is a velocity of light in the vacuum with the ratio of the velocity of light in the medium, which is obviously every time it is changed. Next is the numerical aperture, which is a light gathering capacity of a lens. And it is basically directly proportional to the angle of acceptance. And that's why the numerical aperture is higher if the lens is very near to the sub stage, and it is only happen in the case of higher magnification. Because in case of higher magnification, the lens and the object is very near, the working distance is less. And if the working distance is less, means the numerical aperture is higher. So what is the rule of the microscope when you're using into the lab? Most of the microscopes are portable. So always when you replace it from one place to another place, then always carry with the two hands, one on the arm and second one on the base. Use always a lens cleaner or lens paper for cleaning the lens. Many times people is using the clothes or the normal tissue paper. It is basically, if you're using those type of things, then chances of scratching on the lenses is increased. So don't use those type of papers. Always use the lens paper. Then don't play with the force knobs. Force and coarse knob is there in the microscope. Don't play with that. Next is up, always store the covered form. If it is open form, then chances of the lots of dust and the artifacts is reached to and stick on the lenses. Be careful with the cords. Then place the slide on the stage and use the stage clips to secure the slide. Otherwise, might be possible your slide is moving here and there. And finally, the adjust the nose piece to the lower setting. Always, when you finish your work, always keep the microscope objective lens on the lower side, because in the lower objective lens, the stage distance is higher, the chances of scratching of the lens is reduced. And finally, if you want to see the object through the microscope, always see with the eyepieces. So there is a different parts of the microscope. You can see here, this is an eyepiece. With the help of that, you can see the objects. This is a body tube. Body tube is basically the thing which is present for mainly focus the object with the objective lens. Means this eyepiece, how you can see the things while the only the object is seen by the objective lens. So this particular body tube is working the distance where the all the object which is basically seen by the objective lens, it can easily reach to the eyepieces, and you can see that. This is a resolving nose piece. Resolving nose piece is containing the different type of objective lens which you can move and change the lenses. These are the objective lens. With the help of that, you can observe the objects. This is a stage clips, which is present just to secure your slides. This is a diaphragm. Diaphragm is basically the light gathering capacity. You can increase and decrease the intensity of light with the help of this particular component, which is present in the your microscopes. This is a light source from where the light is coming. This is a base. This is a fine adjustment knob and the coarse adjustment knob. Coarse adjustment knob is basically used for just up and down of your stage. And fine adjustment knob is used for the focusing the object. This is a stage where you keep the slides. This is the arm, which is basically used mostly for the carrying the microscope from one place to the another place. So these are the different important component of the microscope. And actually these specific component is changing and they develop the different type of microscope. If you clear with the compound microscope, you can develop any type of the other microscopes. So now come to the compound microscope. So in the compound microscope, which is the most common one into the your laboratory, and almost all have worked with this particular compound microscope, which is basically based on the intensity of the light absorbed by the sample. And on the basis of absorption, actually the sample contrast is creating, and then you can observe the things. And this type of microscope is basically using the transmitted light, which is illuminated. And this transmitted light is coming from here, means light is coming and transmit through the sample, which is present on the stage. And that is the reason in the stage, in between the small hole is present, through which the light is coming and transmit through the sample and reach to the your objective lens. And from the objective lens, it reached to your eyepiece, and eyepiece through the eyepiece, it reached to your eyes. So transmitted light is illuminated through the compound microscope. It provides the two-dimensional images. It never provides the three-dimensional images, but because it is based on the absorption, so staining is required to view the specimen. And second thing, the field of this particular microscope is bright. So also to make the contrast, the staining is required. And it is having the high magnification up to the 100x, and low magnification is 4x or 10x, which is applicable. It is by the different type of companies using the different type of low magnification. And the resolution of this particular microscope is low, that is a 200 nanometer only. Means if the two things is in the distance of 200 nanometer, then you can distinguish it. If it is 190, 180 or 100 nanometer, you cannot distinguish with the help of this particular compound microscope. This is the optical path of the microscope. You know very well, there's in the lenses, lens system in the optics, there's a three rays is coming. One is a parallel, second is going through the middle of the lens, and third one is through the focus. If it is coming from the parallel to and strike on the lens, it always goes through the focus. And second is, which is coming from the mid of the lenses, it always, without any diffraction, it goes as it is. And the next one is a ray, which is a going through the focus, it always comes parallel and reach to the another side of the lenses. So same principle, it is working. If the object is placed here and one ray is coming parallel and second is coming through the lens, then it forms the image which is in large form as compared to the object one. So in this way, the normal, and this is in case of magnifying lenses, where the only one lens is used, and that is the reason why you always see the object in the enlarged form. The reason is the optics behind this particular lens. And if it is a compound microscope where the two different lenses, and both lenses is the basically the convex lenses, then in this case, what will happen? The object is placed behind the your objective lens, and it form an image which is an intermediate image in some before the, just before the eyepieces. And eyepiece, for the eyepiece, it work as a your object, and it form another image, and that image is basically the enlarged form of image. And that's why with the help of compound microscope, when you see the images, that images is enlarged form, which is not the actual case. This is actually the virtual images which you have seen that. So now come to the, what is the forensic application of the compound microscope? So compound microscope is basically used for the botanical evidence identification, like pollen, molds, and fungal spores. You can observe with the help of the compound microscope. Apart from that, the medulla and scale pattern can also be identified with the help of this compound microscope. And even you can observe whether it is a human hair or animal hair, you can distinguish with the help of compound microscope, because the medulla for the, all these particular species is differentiated. And on the basis of that, you can, species can be identified with the help of compound microscope. Means if you got the hair on the crime scene, with the help of compound microscope, you can identify which species it is belong, whether it is belong to the human or the animal. Apart from that, the ethnic origin is also identified with the help of the cortex color, because the Caucasian and the European hairs, our cortex is some little bit of orange red color, while the brown red color is coming in the Mongoloid and Asians, and also in the Indians. And Africans is somewhat different cortex color as compared to the other ethnic origin persons. And with the help of this particular compound microscope, you can identify the different type of fibers also. So these are the application of the compound microscope. Now come to the second one, which is the most commonly used for the question document. And this is a stereomicroscope. Why the stereomicroscope is required? Why they develop this type of microscope? So with the help of compound microscope, basically when they use those type of microscope, they can see the things which is very small, but they cannot see the changes if they want to see in the cockroach. Cockroach is also small. You can see with the naked eyes, but as compared to bacteria, their size is higher, and you cannot keep the cockroach on the normal compound microscope. So they think in this direction, if they increase the working distance and they stick off only one objective lens, then might be possible we can see these type of small insects, what is the changes or how they are looking in the enlarged form. Since then they have developed this particular stereomicroscope, which is also called as a dissection microscope, because the dissection, for the dissection purposes, for the fruit fly dissections, for the cockroach dissection, they require this particular microscope, because with the naked eyes you cannot do that, because that particular part means if you want to see the nerve ring inside the particular cockroach, then you cannot do that with the naked eyes. You need some enlarged instrument which can enlarge the images. So those type of thing is basically the stereomicroscope. Stereomicroscope is basically working on the reflected light illuminated, while the compound microscope is working with on the transmitted light illumination. Here it is formed the 3D images, but this 3D image is actually the virtual 3D image. This is not the actual 3D image which is formed. And here, the individual cells cannot be seen with the help of this microscope. The reason they are using the very low magnification, and their magnification range is 2x to 125x only. In the forensic science, how we can apply this stereomicroscope. So this stereomicroscope is used for the various applications like soil analysis in the case of entomology to identify the insects. And with the help of this insects, you can identify the time since death. Then minutiae identification, which sometimes it is difficult with the hand magnifying lenses to identify the minutiae. So in those conditions, you can use this particular microscope because magnifying lens magnification is almost 6x to 10x, while in case of a stereo microscope, it is up to the 125x. Then pores can also be seen by the help of a stereo microscope, which you cannot see with the help of normal compound microscope. Then paint, physical matches, then question document where the examination of ink, erasers, texture of the papers, as well as the other impression evidences can also be seen with the help of this particular stereo microscope, where you can see here is the detail of the suspect document, pen over the toner, which can identify with the help of this stereo microscope. Then the embossed elements, which is present on the currency note, it can be easily identified with the help of a stereo microscope. Then fibers, which is basically different type of wave patterns, you can easily identify with the help of a stereo microscope, which is not possible with the help of compound microscope, because the fiber thickness is higher as compared to the range of which is used in case of compound microscope. And here another one is basically the images of the fingerprints, where not only the minutiae but the pores can also be seen, and even the edges also can be easily seen with the help of this particular stereo microscope. So these are the application of stereo microscope in the field of forensic. Now come to the next one, which is the most important microscope, which is used in the field of forensic. That is a compound microscope. Compound microscope is basically the combination of two different type of compound or stereo microscope. If you join two stereo microscope with the help of some bridges, or the compound microscope with the help of two bridges, you can easily make the compound microscope. Second thing is that with the help of this compound microscope, side by side comparison can be performed, which is not possible with the help of stereo microscope as well as with the help of compound microscope. And that is the reason what is the significance of compound comparison microscope in the field of forensic. With the help of this particular microscope, we can side by side compare the different type of bullets, their firing pin marks, their breech face marks, ejector and extractor marks, as well as the tool marks can be identified with the help of this particular compound microscope if you want to observe in the comparatively. Then hair and fiber can be identified, means hair and fiber can be identified with the help of compound microscope also. But if there is a one question sample and one reference sample is present, so how with the, how you can do the same time you can observe both the particular samples? So for those things, basically the compound microscope is comparison microscope has been used. And the physical matches for the paint chips, means the how the layering is going on, how the color is there, what is the thickness of the paint, it can be easily compared with the help of the comparison microscope. But definitely for the comparison microscope, two different evidences or the two different samples should be required. One is a question and second one is a reference one. Next one is a polarizing microscope, which is developed. Why? Because with the help of compound microscope, comparison microscope and the stereo microscope, it is very difficult to identify whether the fiber is a synthetic or the normal origin, means that is a natural one or a synthetic one. Because in the synthetic, the two different type of or more materials can be used, and they are having the birefringent properties, means the two different type of refractive index, so that they develop the, they change the improvise the compound microscope. And they use the two different part into it, which is introduced in the new microscope. First one is a polarizer and second one is an analyzer. And only with the help of these two things, they convert the compound microscope into the normal polarized microscope. And in this one, why the polarizer is used, what is the role of polarizer? So polarizer is used just above the light source, because when the light is coming from the light source, it is in the all direction. And if you want to make it in the only one direction, then the polarizer is used, and polarizer gives the one direction to the particular light sources. And then the light, this is a plane polarized light, is basically strike on your birefringent specimen. And after that, because it is having the two different type of refractive index, when the rays come out from this birefringent specimen, again it is produced another extraordinary rays apart from the normal ordinary rays. And that extraordinary rays is basically because of the second refractive index of particular material. The thing is, how these two different type of rays, because another component used in the particular microscope, that is the analyzer. And this analyzer is just perpendicular to the polarizer. And when they are using the analyzer, the extraordinary rays and ordinary rays are conjoined together and they form the images. And once it forms the images, that is the cross-structure. That is showing the birefringent property of the particular compound. What is the forensic application of the polarized light microscope? So basically, for seeing the texture of the soil sample, because soil sample having the different type of minerals, and different type of minerals is having the different type of refractive index. So to see and observe the particular soil sample and the minerals inside the soil sample, they are using the polarized light microscope, as well as to identify the artificial fiber also, they are using this particular microscope. And apart from that, there's a lots of other application also comes with the help of the polarized light microscope, like microchemical testing, where the different type of crystal is formed. It can be easily observed with the help of polarized light microscope, where the nitrate sample is present, and nitrate is present most of the time in the sample which is containing the explosives. So explosive is easily identified with the help of the polarized light microscope, as well as the different type of samples like illicit drugs like cocaine or methamphetamine, which is also giving the different type of crystal structure. It is also identify whether this particular white powder is a cocaine or not. You can identify with the help of the polarized light microscope. The same time, the white powder hoax, which is started in 1992 when the anthrax attack on the US, that terrorist attack is basically the biological warfare agent, and because of anthrax, and anthrax is also the white powder. After that, in 2001, 2013, they sent some white powder and they said that this is a terrorist activity. So observe those particular object inside this particular microscope with the help of polarized microscope, easily identify whether that is an anthrax powder or it is a normal corn starch powder. So this is also helpful in the field of the fake things, which is many times happen in the different country and different terrorist group is doing in this way. So to avoid those things and overcome those issues, polarized microscope is essentially used in the field of forensic science. After the bright field microscope, the dark field microscope concept came. The reason behind that, before all these microscope, which is related to compound microscope, you can see the things which is basically not, you can say, the transparent object. Transparent object you cannot see by the compound microscope. But to see the transparent object, they need to how to create the contrast. And how to create the contrast, if your field become dark, then easily you can observe the things which is basically transparent in nature. So for those things, the scientists think in this direction and they develop the annular diaphragm, because they know that diaphragm is basically the component which is present inside the microscope, which is basically used to gather the light coming from the light sources. And because of this only, the intensity becomes changed and the bright field and the images become contrast. So if they change this particular annular diaphragm, diaphragm, and make it annular, means the only one ring structure is basically open and rest all structure become opaque, then easily only the light source comes through this particular region, which is transparent in nature, then it is reached to the compound, particular sample. And once it is reached to the sample, the scattering is going on. Before that, all the sample is forming the images through the transmission or the reflected light sources. But here, it is formed the images due to the scattering which is going on through the annular ring structure of diaphragm, and they form the images. And in this way, all the rays which is forming the background, which is coming from this region, it is already blocked with the help of the annular diaphragm. And if it is blocked, then obviously no light is coming to the background, forming the background image. So background is become dark and image is become brighter. So in this particular microscope, no any staining is required. So live sample can be easily viewed with the help of dark field microscope, which is not possible with the help of the your normal compound microscope. So what is the forensic application? How the dark field microscope used in this particular field? So dark field microscope help to see the diatoms. Most of the diatoms or all the diatoms are transparent in nature. So diatoms can be seen with the help of the dark field microscope, as well as the plant spores and the pollen grains can be easily identified and easily visualized with the help of the dark field microscope. This is a major application in the field of forensic, the dark field microscope. After dark field microscope, the people think again in the direction, if we can view the objects which are basically dead, or if they are living, they are very small. So how we can see the normal human being cells, means eukaryote cells. Before that, all the things which you can see, that is the prokaryotes in nature. So how we can see the eukaryote cells, they develop another microscope, which is called as a phase contrast microscope. Why it is called phase contrast? Because the phase contrast is generated and they form the images. And that's why it is called as a phase contrast microscope, where the two different type of light, which is one is a direct light, second is a refracted light, bring together and form the images. And that's why it is called as a phase contrast microscope. So how it creates the phase contrast, you can see here, there's a light source is coming from the light, light is coming from the light source. One light is without deviation, means without impact on the sample, it is forming the wave motion. While second light, which is strike on the sample, after that, it become change the deviate their wavelength, because once any type of light source is strike through the sample, then definitely there is some changes into the amplitude is occur. And that amplitude changes is lambda by 2 when the only one light source is strike on the sample and second light source is still not any deviation occur. So this is a natural wave motion of the light, while this particular amplitude is lagging behind. The reason behind why it has happened, because of the impact with the sample. So this particular changes in the wavelength, that is a lambda by 2. And then when those two rays is enter into the and strike on the phase plate is also made up of the two different type of layer. One is a phase shifting layer and second is the attenuating layer. So when the light is going through the attenuating layer, which is undeviated, it again undeviated and goes through the objective lens, to the eyepieces, while the rays which is already lagging behind by the lambda by 2, again on the phase shifting plate, they again strike on that particular region, and again phase shifting is going on, and that phase shift is almost again the lambda by 2. So first lambda by 2 lagging and second lambda by 2 lagging is equal to the lambda by 4. Sorry, lambda by 4 and lambda by 4 is equal to lambda by 2. So in this way, in this, after the phase plate, once it is coming out rays and reach to the lens, in this condition, if you see the wave motion, here the amplitude is on the upper side, and here the amplitude on the lower side, which is contrast to each other. So this lambda by 4 lagging on the first time and lambda by 4 lagging on the second time, conjoined together, lambda by 4 plus lambda by 4 is equal to lambda by 2 difference. And this lambda by 2 difference is creating the contrast. And in this way, the image can be seen with the help of this particular phase contrast microscope. With the help of this phase contrast microscope in the forensic, the diatoms can be seen. Second is a sperm, live sperm can be seen with the help of this particular microscope, while compound microscope is helping to see the view the sperm in the dead form, because after staining it is used. Then the spores, plant spores can be seen, as well as the RBCs also can be seen with the help of this particular phase contrast microscope. These are the application of phase contrast microscope in the field of forensic science. Come to the next microscope. Till now, microscope which is used, those are using the light sources, normal light sources, and they are working on the principle of the visible light source, means visible wavelength. But fluorescent microscope is somewhat different from these type of microscope, where the fluorescent microscope concept, what is the fluorescent concept? When the light is coming and strike on any of the compound or sample, immediately what will happen, when the light source, which is the energy source, is strike any sample, and the sample is excited and they excited and goes to the ground state, to the higher state, and that state is a basically the excited one. After the excitement, you know very well, no one is stable at the excited state in the chemistry as well as in the biology. So after the excitement, what will happen, after few minutes it release the electron beams or release the energies, and after releasing the energy they try to reach to the ground state, and the energy which is emitted out from after the excitement and reach to the ground state, that is called as a fluorescence emission. These are kind called as a fluorescence. Here in Zablonski equation also you can see the how the molecules are excited and goes to the excited state, and after the excitement the internal conversion and inter system conversion is going on. There is a two different phenomena. If the internal conversion is going on, means internal conversion is immediately started and those type of emission is called as a fluorescence, and inter system crossing which is going on here, it take little bit more time because that there is a changes from the S1 to the T1, it take little bit more time, and this triplet state, from the singlet state to triplet state formation, it is released the energy little bit after the excitement, and that is called as a phosphorescence. Yes, some questions? No? Okay. So this is the phenomena of the fluorescent fluorescence, and on the basis of this particular fluorescence phenomena, they prepare a microscope where with the light source they are using this particular phenomena and develop a microscope where you can see the object which is giving the fluorescence. And this fluorescent phenomena is given by the Stoke, and it is called as a Stoke shift, where when the energy is going to the excited state, the absorption peak is forming the excitation shift. And this excitation shift is basically changed when the emission is going on. So emission energy is always higher than the excitation one. Means excitation energy is always less and the emission energy is always higher. And this shifting of this energy from the absorption to the emission is called as a Stoke shift. And this is a basic phenomena of the fluorescent microscope, where the fluorescent microscope is working. In this particular fluorescent microscope, basically the filters are used. These filters are called as an excitation filter and an emission filter. And in the excitation filter and emission filter also, they are subdivided into a different type of filter, like short pass filter, long pass filter, dichromic beam filter. Why they are called in this way? The short pass filters are those that the shorter length of light, but they can block the long length of light. Because in case of fluorescent microscope, to excite the molecule, you require a specific type of wavelength of the light. And that's why these type of different type of filters are used. So short pass filter only pass the shorter wavelength, not the longer one. Long pass filter is passing the long pass, long wavelength light, but not the lower one, means the UV light cannot pass and the visible light can be passed in this way. And third one is a dichromic filter. Dichromic beam filter is basically a specific characteristic used in this particular microscope just to give the direction of the excited light, means the light which is coming from the light source, and emitted light to give the path towards the barrier filter. So this, in this one, the first part is reflected the light and second is a pass, means shorter wavelength light can be reflect and the longer wavelength light can be passed. So those type of filter is used in the dichromic filter, dichromatic beam splitter, which is present in this one. This is a filter structure. This is an excitation filter. This is a emission filter. And in this one, this blue color which you have seen, this is a dichromatic beam splitter. So light is coming from this. Emission filter is most commonly used is a short pass filter, and this short pass filter is passing only shorter wavelength of light, which is reflect towards the sample which is present in this direction. It is basically present on the 45 degree of angle. And once this particular reflection of light reached to this particular sample, which is present here, sample get excited because of the strike of the photons and they emit the energy, and that energy is higher than the, they absorb, whatever they absorb the wavelength. And once this particular light is coming and reach to the beam splitter, this beam splitter is basically past this particular light because their wavelength is higher than the lower, shorter wavelength. So it can pass this particular light and it reaches the emission, and then the different light you can observe by the your naked eyes. Means you are using the blue filter, but you can see the green lights. So why it has happened? Because the blue filter is, blue light is having the shorter wavelength as compared to the green one. So that's why always emission light wavelength is higher than the excitation one. So this is happened in the fluorescent microscope. And what is the application of this fluorescent microscope in the field of forensic? So here, which you have seen this particular picture, this is a picture of a hair. Hair can be seen. So the question is, why the hair seen with the help of fluorescent microscope? The reason, if the hair is a colored hair, then fluorescent microscope, the, all the coloring agent is having the different type of fluorescent tendency, and those fluorescent tendency can be observed over here. So you can easily say that this particular hair is a natural black or natural color, or this is a basically the artificial or synthetic color has been used in this particular hair sample. Second is that this particular DNA which is present here, you can see that this is a single cell DNA, and if the cell's DNA is intact, is not degraded, then it looks like a comet picture, means a round picture. And if it is a degraded DNA, then you can find the comet tail is coming, and that tail is indicating the basically a degradation of the DNA. This is a new method which is basically introduced by myself in the field of forensic to check the whether the sample is degraded or not just before the DNA fingerprinting. Means many times what will happen, even I heard most of the cases in the inaugural session, the someone explained this thing. There's a lots of cases which is in 1983 happened, and it is still not open. So what about those type of sample? Those type of sample is integrated. This is not integrated. Their integrity of those sample is questioned, because after so much long time, and what is their storage, might be possible those biological sample is degraded. So check those degradation. We are using the single cell gel electrophoresis method just before the DNA fingerprinting. If they are using this particular method, so they are not going to the most costly method of fingerprinting. Instead of very small method, very cheap method, that is a single cell gel electrophoresis method. With the help of that, they can easily identify whether the sample is degraded or not. Even if the sample is less degraded, then how they can repair those DNA, it can be also possible with the help of this particular technology. This is a stain of the seminal samples, which can be give the fluorescence. Here you can see the currency notes, which is having the different type of fibers, which is a fluorescent fiber present on the particular currency. And this is also another latest branch, that is the forensic nanotechnology, where the different type of fluorescent nanopowder is used to develop the fingerprints. Why these type of compounds is used? The reason is that when you are using the normal powders of fingerprint powders, then sometimes what will happen, and most of the time they stick with the background also. So making the contrast between the fingerprints as with the background is a little bit difficult. So for those things, they developed this nanopowder. Nanopowder is specifically stick only on the region of the fingerprints where the amino acids is present, basically. Where the sweat is present, where the amino acid is present, they only stick on that particular surface. Rest all the surface, they are not sticking. And in this way, the better contrast is generated. So this is the application of the nanopowder, which is used in the fingerprint. But obviously, they are fluorescent in nature. So you cannot see the So these are the forensic application of the fluorescent microscope. Sophisticated technique in the field of microscopy, which is right now used, that is electron microscopes. Electron microscope is a special type of microscope where the high resolution of image able to magnify the object in the nanometer scale range, as well as they form the control use of the electron in the vacuum and capture through the phosphorescent screen. So in this particular to the electron microscope, before that you can see here, this is an image where when the electron beam is a strike on any surface, there's a different type of electron beams is basically emitted out. Some are X-rays, some are secondary electrons, some are inelastic scattering, some are direct beam is also going on, some are elastic scattering of the electron is going on. Then auger electron is also removing from the surface, similar to the secondary electron, and the backscatter electron, which is coming from the nucleus. So there's a different type of electron beam is basically emitted out when the electron beam strike on the surfaces. And for all these particular electron beam is having the different type of characteristics, and they use for the different type of image formation. For example, secondary electrons is used for the scanning electron microscope image formation. secondary electron is released from the surfaces. When it is released from the surfaces, so surface morphology, what is the surface morphology present on that particular sample? It can be seen only with the help of secondary electron. Auger electron is another one which is also coming from the surfaces, but little bit below the surfaces. So morphological structure you cannot see with the help of auger electron, but another parameters which is not used right now in the field of forensic, they can be used by the help of the auger electron microscope. Backscatter electron microscope is basically coming from the nucleus, and all the element is having the different type of molecule, atomic numbers and atomic weights. So their nucleus structure is also changed, so that when they are coming from the backscattering, from electron is coming out from the nucleus, then it is actually working as a fingerprint of the elements. So for the different elements, different type of backscattering is producing, means the scattering range, scattering angle is different from each and every element. And that's why this particular backscattering electron is used for the purpose of making the contrast. Means if the atoms are heavier, means element are heavier, means atomic number nucleus is higher, then it is creating more contrast image into the image formation as compared to the lighter ones. For example, if there's a two compounds, one is a sodium, second is a arsenic, is used in the sample. Once the backscatter electron is coming out from here, so sodium is basically giving the brighter image, while the arsenic is giving the darker image, because arsenic is having the higher atomic number as compared to the sodium. So this is the use of the backscatter electron. So in case of electron microscope, instead of the light, electron beam is used as a source for producing the images. And here, compound microscope can be magnified with the 2000x, while in case of electron microscope, it can be magnified up to the 1 lakh. So you can imagine how many times the magnifying the images as compared to the compound microscope you can see with the help of the electron microscope. And this electron microscope is basically two types. One is a transmission electron microscope, and second one is a scanning electron microscope. So in the case of scanning electron microscope, the electrons are reflected from the surface of the specimen, means it is forming the images only which is coming from the surfaces. Means surface information, if you want the surface information of any object, then you can use the scanning electron microscope. It produces a 3D images because the image is formed because of the reflection of the light. Why we can see the 3D images? Because our eyes also can see the reflected images. Reflected light is forming the images, and that's why we can see the 3D images. Similarly, in the scanning electron microscope, because the image is formed, the secondary electron, which is reflected from the surface, that's why it is forming the 3D images. It is good for the thicker specimen, means thick sample or bulk sample object is also can be seen with the help of scanning electron microscope. And its magnification is very high, which is almost 1 lakh or more than that. And resolution is up 0.4 nanometer, means if the two object is just 0.4 nanometer in the difference, it can also be resolved with the help of the scanning electron microscope. The question is how the scanning electron microscope is working. So here is the electron gun. Electron gun is releasing the electron beams, and this electron beams, when it is coming out, it is uncontrolled electron beams. And for the uncontrolled electron beams, to control this particular beam, they are using the anode. And anode system is basically condense these particular electron beam towards the one direction. And this particular one directional electron beam is then passed through the condenser lens. Here the glass condenser lens cannot be used similar to the normal compound microscope, because if you're using the glass condenser, then what will happen? When the electron beam is coming, their penetration power is very high, then immediately the glass is break down. So that's why in this particular type of microscope, they are using the different type of condenser system, which is the electromagnetic condenser system. Why they are electromagnetic condenser system is used? Because the electron beam is having the electromagnetic properties. And if you are using this type of condenser system, so it cannot affect on the particular condenser, and it can condense the beam towards the sample where the sample is present. And once it is reached to the sample, the deflection coil is present over here. It is moving in the raster movement. Raster movement is similar to this. Means first it goes in this direction, then downwards, then backward, then again it is down, then forward. So this is called as a raster movement. So this deflection coil is moving in this particular direction, and the light electron beam is one by one reached to this particular sample, and they forming the images in the form of pixel because the secondary electron is releasing, and here the secondary electron detector and the X-ray detector, because many times the SEM is basically combined with the EDX, energy dispersive spectroscopy. So because the X-ray is also coming out, this X-ray detector is basically detected. And the backscatter electron detector is also present, which is basically help to create the contrast image formation, while X-ray detector is used to identify the elements, because all the element is having the different peaks of the X-rays, which is basically identify the elements. So with the help of this particular three detectors, backscatter electron detector, which is creating the differentiation between the two elements in the form of their atomic numbers, means lighter is brighter and heavier is darker, while X-ray detector is detecting the element, means qualitative analysis can be done by the help of backscatter, but the quantitative and the name of that particular element can be done by the X-ray detector. And secondary electron detector is basically using for the forming the image of your surface. What is a present on that particular surface? What is the morphology of the surface? It can be detected with the help of the secondary electron detector. So in this way, the scanning electron microscope is working. Next one is a transmission electron microscope, which is also used in the similar way. The only difference is that in this particular microscope, there is no deflection coil is used, because the name transmission electron microscope means electron beam should transmit through the specimen and it reached to the phosphorescent screen. So it formed the images because of the transmission of the electron. So in this particular microscope, the magnification is higher than the scanning electron microscope. Resolution is almost similar, not similar. In the case of SEM, that is a 0.4 nanometer, while in case of transmission electron microscope, it is more lower, it is a 0.5 angstrom. But it forms the 2D images because it is forming the image because of transmission, not by the reflection. And that's why it forming the 2D images. In this particular microscope, the thin sample is required. Thick sample cannot be run, because if you are taking the thick sample, all the electron beam cannot be transmitted through this particular thick sample, and image become distorted. So that's why the thin sample specimen is used in this particular transmission electron microscope. And in this particular microscope, because they are using the thin section, they also staining is also going on in this particular microscope, because backscatter detector is not used. So making the contrast, they are using the stainings. That staining is used by the different heavy metals compounds. And they form the images only of the dead cells, means dead cell can be observed through this particular microscope, and it is forming the 2D images. What is the forensic application of and rest all the phenomena in the transmission electron microscope is similar to the scanning electron microscope, means electron beam is produced from the electron gun, then anode is just to conjoin all the electron beam, and it accelerate and reach to the magnetic lens region, where it is again condensed towards the sample, and the sample through the sample it is transmitted, and it reached to the phosphorescent screen where it formed the images. So what is the forensic application of scanning and transmission electron microscope? So here you can see the different type of images where the it is a fibers. Different type of fibers can be identified with the help of scanning electron microscope, because they all the fibers is having the different type of surface morphology. So on the basis of that, you can easily identify it. Second is minute to minute designing or morphology which is present on the diatoms with the help of the scanning electron microscope, which is present on their surfaces. Then this is a hair sample. With the help of a scanning electron microscope, you can observe the hair. And even if this hair is containing the some materials, like it is containing the arsenic or the other drugs compound which is present on the hair, it can be identified with the help of scanning electron microscope. Again, here GSR, gunshot residues can be analyzed with the help of the scanning electron microscope. Now the question is, all the application is only belong to the scanning electron microscope. So what about the transmission electron microscope? How the transmission electron microscope can be used in the field of forensic? So till now, the transmission electron microscope is used for the purpose of to characterize the nanomaterials, which is applicable in the field of forensic science. So characterization means their size, their monodispersity, their polydispersity. It can be checked with the help of the transmission electron microscope. So these are the application of electron microscope. Some more application like pollens, you can easily observe different type of pollen is having the different type of morphology, which can be seen by the help of the scanning electron microscope. And also the RBCs, after the some point, what will happen? They are destroying himself. Or if it is come water, blood is come out of the environment, then also this particular structure of the RBCs is just start distorting. So with the help of this particular images, we can quantify, qualitative analysis can be done for the time since death. Means approximation can do if the most of the cell is become distort, means this is not the fresh blood, it is a older blood. So these type of application can be used with the help of the scanning electron microscope. So this is all about the forensic microscopy, means the application of different type of microscope in the field of forensic science. So in this way, in the last, I would like to thank to organizers to invite me here to share my knowledge with the students. Thank you very much. Yes, questions? Hello? Guys, can you hear me?
Any participants have any question, you can raise your hands.
So we have one participant who is raising the hand. Gaurav, go ahead. Gaurav, you have to unmute your microphone from your side. So meanwhile, we have a question. What does it mean by birefringence?
Birefringence is basically the when the any type of material is having the two different type of refractive index. Those type of material is called as a birefringence.
Right. Alok, go ahead. Mr. Alok, go ahead. Alok Kumar.
Hello.
Yeah, Alok.
So my question is, how the electron, normal electron and auger electron are differentiated?
Which electron?
Auger.
Auger electron is a different from the scanning electron microscope. Reason behind that, auger, in the case of auger electron, electrons is coming from the inside of the orbitals. While in case of secondary electron is released from the outer orbital only. So
my question is, how these are differentiated?
Which one?
So yeah, both secondary electron or be it backscattered electron or be it auger electron.
That's why I'm telling you, all the electron beam which is basically emitted out, they are having the different type of properties. Different type of properties in sense of their depth. How much depth they can go and release, emit the electrons. So like secondary electron is releasing the electron from the outer orbital, while auger electron is basically strike from the outer inner one, inner electron is released, then the second electron which is create a space, the outer energy electron orbital is move to the second innermost region and finally release those energy which is released from outer orbital and goes to the inner orbital, that energy is called as a auger electron. So these are the different type of properties of the electron which is emitted from.
Okay.
That's why they are different type of detector can.
Sir, Gaurav?
Yeah, Gaurav.
Hello.
Yeah, Gaurav.
Hello.
Yeah.
Sir, I want to ask the scanning electron microscope broadly applications.
Broadly applications, if you want to see the surface morphological structure of any of the object, you can use the scanning electron microscope. But you cannot put your hand on that one, obviously. There is some limitation for the scanning electron microscope also. So there is some limitation in sense of thickness of the sample. So that type of sample you can see with the help of the scanning electron microscope. Scanning electron microscope role is only to see the surface morphology, not the inside. If you want to see the inside the things which is present in the object, then you can use the transmission electron microscope. So any type of samples, if you want to see their surface morphology, you can use the scanning.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Sir, very good morning.
Good morning.
Sir, is there any sample preparation to run any sample in transmission electron microscope, sir?
Yes. For the transmission electron microscopy procedure is little bit tedious because the carcinogenic chemical is used for the preparation. And it is a 3-day process. This is not happening in the one day. You want the sample, you have to first day, you have to do the primary fixatives you have to use. Then after secondary fixative is used. After secondary fixatives, you are going to use the propylene oxide for another purpose for fixation. And then when the fully your sample is fixed, then you are going to use the microtomes. Microtomes is an instrument with the help of that you can cut the sections, and that section thickness range is 70 nanometer, not more than that. 70 nanometer thick sample only can be seen by the transmission electron microscope. So this is all about the transmission electron microscopy sampling. In case of scanning electron microscopy, also the sampling is required, but sampling is not much difficult. That sampling is required in case of if the sample is non-conductive in nature. For example, the biological samples are non-conductive. So for those things, we need to coating of the gold or palladium particles. If you are using those ones, so it becomes conductive. Only the conductive sample can release the electron easily. If sample is non-conductive in nature, so it cannot release the electron properly and then distort images form. So that's why if the sample is a non-conductive in nature, so make it conductive and then you can use it.
Sir, one more. Hello?
Yeah. Please.
Well, sir, in transmission electron microscope, can we use the samples, solid samples, or only liquid samples, or only biological samples? It can be, we can use.
In case of transmission electron microscope or the scanning electron microscope, if you are using the liquid sample, you have to dry it. Okay.
Huh.
In case of transmission electron microscope, that is a dehydration process is going on. Fine. And fixative process. So obviously you are going to solidify your sample. In case of scanning electron microscope, also the dehydration is going on.
Okay.
So without dehydration, you cannot use. Why it is happening? Why liquid sample cannot run? The reason is that if you are putting the liquid sample inside the particular scanning or transmission electron microscope, so in this particular microscope, the vacuum is created.
Huh.
And if the vacuum is created and you are using the particular sample which is liquidified, though in those conditions, what will happen? The sample image is distorted and form the round hole in this one. Means you cannot identify the sample easily.
Okay.
Because electron is not coming out from there.
Hmm.
So that's why for the scanning and normal transmission electron microscope, you have to dry the sample and then only you can use for those purposes. While in case of cryo-electron microscope, you can put the liquid sample now.
Okay, sir.
Because their vacuum is not so much high.
Okay, sir. Sir, yeah. Is there any application in the forensic, usually we can use a scanning tunneling microscope, sir?
Scanning tunneling microscope is used basically for the atomic level of the structure. Right now, only the atomic force microscope is used for the forensic purpose.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Which is a part of the scanning electron microscope. Yeah.
Good morning, sir.
Good morning.
Sir, actually, while doing characterization part for nanoparticles,
okay.
Like metal oxides, we prepare films for doing SEM, but we have powder. So can you suggest some other method, like if we can make pellets out of that, so that we do not have to prepare films for running the sample or something?
In case of metal oxide nanoparticle, if you want to characterize it, characterization of in the nanomaterial is basically for the size and shape and the polydispersity. Okay, so these things can be done with the help of transmission electron microscope, not the scanning electron microscope, first thing. So scanning electron microscope is used for the characterization of those type of nanomaterial, which is basically the conjugated one, which is having the different type of layer on that one. Means if you are using the gold nanoparticle and it is capped with the something else, means if the thiol group is attached with that. So to observe the thiol group is whether attached or not, you can use the scanning electron microscope. But if you want to see the size and shape of the particular nanomaterial, you can use the transmission electron microscope, not the scanning electron microscope.
So, but when we have to submit our papers, they ask for SEM. So anyhow, we have to submit that. So we make films and that after coating, we use that for...
No, not require. If you can put your sample in the powder form, it can also work.
Okay. So in the form of pellets or directly?
Not exactly the directly. There's a process through which you can do that. It is possible. You can do.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
On the screen, one of the participants has asked, how is the recent super resolved fluorescence microscopy different than that of fluorescence microscopy?
In case of normal fluorescent microscope, the 2D images form. Okay. And their range is not in the nano dimension range, nanoscale range. They are not resolved the images up to the nanoscale. While the super resolved nanoscale fluorescent microscopy, which is developed in 2014, they are basically reached to the nano dimension range, means they can resolve the images up to the nano dimension, similar to the electron microscope, and they're forming the 3D images, which is not possible with the help of the normal fluorescent microscope. So this is the advancement of the fluorescent microscope.
And the follow question is that, can we observe live sample in SEM and TEM?
in case of SEM and TEM, both, you cannot run the live sample because there is a vacuum is created and then the process is started. So when the sample is put into the vacuum itself, there is no oxygen, obviously the specimen will gone. So only dead sample can be done.
Mr. Sanjeev, you have a follow-up question?
Sir, may I know the how the chromatic aberration is affected with the function of microscope, sir?
Yes. Basically, the reason why they are using the two different type of lenses, this concept is come because of the chromatic aberrations. Because of the chromatic aberrations, what will happen? People, when they are starting using the two different type of lenses, then what will happen? They don't know whether they can put and get the clear image. Because in the chromatic aberration, what is the chromatic aberration? When the focus is basically changed, two different type of focus is creating the abrupt image. That is called as a chromatic aberration. So if they don't know at that moment ki on what distance they can put two different type of lenses to observe the clear image. So that they that particular thing is play an important role in the field of microscopy. When they put the lenses, then you're using the body tube, the distance of body tube is fixed. Why? Because it is basically on the basis of their chromatic aberration. It overcomes the issue of the chromatic aberrations.
Okay, sir. Sir, one more thing. Sir, filters, how they play an important role in microscope? Where we use a different filters for a different samples, or else we use the filter for the unwanted light, to stop the unwanted light source that imparted on samples?
Yeah, very good question. Actually, if you're using the different type of filters for excitation filter, then you require many filters for seeing the object, because every object is having the different type of fluorescence tendency. So might be one object is having is tendency to excite at the 200 nanometer, one is on 300. So every time you are not going to use a different type of filters. So there's a range of the filters is coming. So that's why it decreases the price of the fluorescent microscope. So that's why this concept is coming, the short pass filter and long pass filter. Short pass filter is basically having the range. Range means it is 400 to 600 short pass filter. It means it can pass 4 to 600 wavelength of through that particular filter. So in this way, they are using particular filters into the fluorescent microscope.
Thank you, sir.
Welcome.
Sir, I think we have got enough clarification about the questions which were asked. So with this, I thank you very much for your expertise sharing, sir. Indeed, just to add on to this conversation, at this point in time, we have 147 participants who are taking part in this. Why I am mentioning this number exclusively for this session is because while microscopy is a complete technical subject, okay, and when 147 people are actually watching this, that only means that, you know, this session will be of very high interest from the scientific community, and I believe everybody here have benefited a lot from your session, sir. So thank you very much for once again for your expertise sharing. And I thank all the participants for your active participation in the webinar series here. So just to add on, today we don't have any other sessions. Today we had only one session because many of the students have requested that the data pack of 1.5G is not sufficient for the two lectures in a day. So exactly. For we have only limited one sessions per day from now on. So with this, today we are concluding our session for the day. Thank you one and all for your participation. Have a good day.